Welcome all to the Council on Foreign Relations. I'm Mark Lagon, and I'm an adjunct senior fellow for human rights at the Council, as well as a professor at Georgetown University. And it's a special pleasure to co-sponsor an event with Freedom House. This is part of a larger roundtable series for the Council on Foreign Relations part called Global Stakes in Human Rights, how interests are bound up for the United States and the world in human rights, and they aren't just some silo of values issues, but integral. And that roundtable is part of the International Institutions and Global Governance Program, which is generously funded by the Rabina Foundation. I hope those of you who are interested in this area might want to take part in that roundtable over time. This session is fully on the record, fully for attribution. We ask you to deactivate your handheld devices. There is an adjacent room for those of you who wish to live tweet or get a cell phone to get a hold of someone in the middle of this session, if you like. I want to say a quick word about assessments of the global human rights situation that give grades. This annual report of very high standards gives grades to other countries. The State Department report on human trafficking that I had the pleasure of managing as the anti-human trafficking ambassador also did. And there is quite a stir among other countries' governments and, in fact, among American policymakers who wish to prioritize other matters than human rights about giving grades. And objectivity is always questioned, but in the case of the Freedom House report, there's no reason for objectivity to be questioned. It is a remarkably credible source for years doing this work of looking at political liberties and civil liberties of countries around the globe. And of human rights organizations, it's in a class of its own in terms of being truly nonpartisan and not ideological. It's probably one of the reasons why this report has been a standard for important things like the work of the Millennium Challenge Corporation. In large part, that credibility and serious work is because of the team that Arch Puddington leads, which combines a facility for understanding the details in so many countries around the world with a fair-minded and candid assessment of the way things really are going. It's a special pleasure to share the podium with the president of Freedom House, David Kramer, who is as much of a prince of a human being as he is committed to freedom, democracy, and human rights in the world, and it'll be a delight to listen to this and participate. Thank you for coming to our home here.
Mark, thanks very much. I've been called a lot of things in my life, but never a prince, so I appreciate that very much. It is a real distinct pleasure to partner with you, a longtime friend of mine personally and a collaborator both in and out of government, and many thanks to you and CFR for hosting us today, and thanks to everybody for coming with a fantastic turnout for our Freedom in the World report, which Arch tells me is the 39th issue that we have done. We've been doing this now since about the early 70s, and it is, I think, the gold standard in the community, as Mark said, where we give grades and rankings to countries, and we're very pleased to be able to unveil it here today. I do want to, before we get started, and I turn things over to Arch and then Jill, who will moderate our discussion, and very grateful, Jill, that you're able to join us here today with Tamara and Larry is a great panel. Our thanks to all of you for participating today. The report that we're issuing today would not be possible without the generous and invaluable support of the Smith-Richardson Foundation, the Lynn and Harry Bradley Foundation, and the Lilly Endowment, all of whom have been longtime supporters of our Freedom in the World report, and we are grateful to them for their steadfastness and commitment. Arch has been helped with the tremendous support from four colleagues in our New York office, Jennifer Dunham, Brett Nelson, Eileen Piano, and Tyler Rowlands, and without them, this report would not be possible. Arch is going to come up and give you the overview. I don't want to steal his thunder, but this year's report has some big changes. In fact, some of the biggest changes in gains with Libya, Burma also, and then a significant decline with Mali, where we continue to see the very unfortunate situation there unfold. In Eurasia, Eurasia has nearly replaced the Middle East and North Africa region, is the region of greatest repression, led not least by Vladimir Putin and his Kremlin clique. We also meet today during some very interesting times with what's happening in Venezuela and questions about the future there with the possibility of new elections after elections were held last October, and Mr. Chavez so far staying in Cuba and perhaps not likely to return to his homeland. In China, we have a new leadership taking over and continued protest and opposition to the Chinese leadership. And in the Middle East, we continue to see the tragedy in Syria unfold with death toll now at 60,000, but also opportunities elsewhere in the region where, as a result of the changes that took place now almost 2 years ago in most of the region, we actually see that there are people and forces and movements with whom we can work. And that is a significant change that has lasted over the 2 years, and Arch will get into that more. Lastly, because there are movements and people and initiatives that need our support, this cries out for leadership from the community of democracies, those nations who are democratic nations, wherever they are, in Europe, in Australia, Canada, the United States, in Asia. There is a great need to support those who are trying to fight every day for freedom and human rights in their countries. These brave defenders need our support, and they need the support not least from the United States, which I would argue still needs to be a leader in this field. And we hope with President Obama's second term soon to kick off next week that we will see a reinforcement of that effort. So without further ado, let me turn it over to Arch Puddington, Vice President for Research at Freedom House, who is a staple of the organization and the man who will walk us through this year's findings. Arch, thanks.
Thanks, David. So why don't we go directly to the map of freedom? This is the map of freedom for the year 2012. As you can see, we have an assertive green for free, a very bright yellow for partly free because we want to draw attention to those countries that are where democracy is under contestation, and then a somber purple for not free. And let's go to the next slide. Okay, I just thought it would be worthwhile to give you a sense of perspective here. We've been doing the measurements for freedom in the world since the year 1972, and you can see right there at the bottom that things have changed rather considerably. In 1972, the not free countries predominated. Freedom was basically the province of Western Europe, North America, and a few other scattered locales. But then very quickly after that, you can see things started to change for the better. First, it was in Latin America and in Europe. Then next, well, you had the end of the Cold War. You had communist Europe becoming free and democratic. And you had the Soviet Union collapsing, and initially, and that's reflected in 1992. Many of these countries in Eurasia, like Belarus and Kazakhstan and some of the other countries, actually had elected governments and had partly free scores, and we were somewhat optimistic about their future. More on that later. And then you can see from 2002 to 2012, there's been stagnation, hardly any movement at all. Okay. These are the free, partly free, not free percentages for different regions in the world. Let's look at first at Latin America. The major stories in Latin America were A, the coming of the post-Chavez era. We don't know what that will bring, but what it may bring is change for the better, because it may have an impact on the constellation of countries that are run by demagogic left-wing presidents who have followed in Chavez's footsteps. In one of those countries, Ecuador, it suffered a decline during the past year, as did Paraguay for this impeachment of the president that followed the letter of the law, but certainly not the spirit of democratic practice. I think it's worth noting that President Correa of Ecuador, whose country's scores have declined over the past few years, seems to be positioning himself to possibly succeed President Chavez as the leader of the left-wing faction in Latin America. Okay, next we have Asia. Asia has been one of the modest success stories in the world over the past decade. We've seen special improvements in places like Indonesia, in Philippines, even in Singapore. And during this past year, we saw some important but guarded gains in Burma. Many things have changed in Burma, but on the other hand, this is a country that is still basically run by the same people who ran it as a dictatorship. And there are three, not one, but three different, at least three different ethnic conflicts going on today in the country. So we've been careful on how much improvement to record for Burma. On China, China's score really didn't change during the past year, but of course China had a major change in the leadership. And the new leadership, the seven-man new Politburo, is comprised of men who, in many cases, are responsible for having put together and implemented the system of sophisticated, nuanced control that is the system of control in China today. And there are no reformers in this group. It's unlikely that these men are going to disavow the policies that they've basically been responsible for implementing. So we can go to the next slide. And Central and Eastern Europe, there were very few changes there. The one thing I'd like to mention, though, is that democracy in the Baltics, Central Europe, and the Balkans, their freedom scores have remained relatively unchanged during the European financial crisis. That's impressive, and I think it's a testimony in part to the role that the European Union has played. In fact, if you want a reason, a rationale for the EU getting the Nobel Peace Prize this year, it's in that chart right there, because the EU has played an important role in guaranteeing the democratic practices of the new EU states and setting the bar high enough so that aspiring new members of the EU want to achieve democracy. Next we have, Eurasia. Ah, yes. All right, Eurasia is pretty much the opposite of Central Europe and the Balkans. Eurasia has steadily declined over the past 10 years. During this last year, we saw declines in Russia, in Kazakhstan, and we did see some modest improvements in Georgia, but the region as a whole has been basically in free fall, led by Russia. Russia has set the tone for the other countries in the region, has acted as the model for those countries, has implemented laws that have then been copied by other countries, both in Eurasia and in other parts of the world. to restrict civil society, restrict the press. So we now have a situation in which the scores for political rights and civil liberties for the Eurasia region as a whole are basically at the same level as countries in the Middle East. And that's something new. The Middle East was once by far the lowest ranking region in the world. Now it shares that that with Eurasia. So let's look at the next one. Okay, so first on the Middle East, that yellow band 3 or 4 years ago was much smaller than it is today, much smaller. Since then, Tunisia, Libya, and Egypt have all scored impressive gains, much more guarded in Egypt than the other two, but certainly in Libya and Tunisia, there have been major improvements. They're reflected in the partly free scores. We see the Middle East as the major story of the past year. Major improvements for Libya, less significant improvements for Egypt. Tunisia having retained the improvements that it recorded in the previous year. On the other hand, and I think this is probably largely due as a reaction, a reflection of a reaction against the gains of the Arab Spring, we've seen declines in many other countries in that part of the world. In almost all of the Gulf states, in Jordan, in Lebanon, in Iraq, certainly in Syria, all of these countries over the last year, or in some cases 2 years, have shown declines as their leaders have tried to take measures to prevent the spirit of the Arab uprising from infecting their societies as well. And finally, we have Africa. Africa is the most volatile region of the world. It's the part of the world that has recorded the most substantial gains over the past few years and some of the most substantial declines. Over the past year, we saw three countries move from partly free to not free. That's Sierra Leone, Senegal, and Lesotho. We saw another country that had been in conflict several years ago, Cote d'Ivoire, moved from not free to partly free. So there were important gains in Africa and important gains in countries that are just still coming out of conflict situations. On the other hand, there were also some substantial declines. Mali declined by a massive amount from a free country and an electoral democracy to a not free country in 1 year. And other countries, Nigeria included, also suffered declines because of the activities of radical Islamist groups. So let's go to the next. All right, for the year 2012, we saw a modest decline in the state of world freedom for the seventh consecutive year. Now, I don't want to exaggerate this, but the blue lines show that for 3 years, the first 3 years of the decade, there were more gains than declines, and then for the next seven, there were more declines than gains. And some of these declines and some of these gains are very small. They could be 1 point on our 1 to 100 scale. But nonetheless, the general trajectory has been in a modestly negative direction. The next chart will show you the major winners and losers, I think. Yes, this is over the past 3 years. This shows the country with the most significant declines and then the most significant gains. You'll see that you'll note that the large number of countries among the decliners are from Africa, and a fair number of the countries among the gainers are from the Middle East. So, again, just to sum up very quickly, the past year saw gains in the Middle East, pushback by other Middle East countries, and no progress, and to a certain extent, declines among the major authoritarian countries, Russia, China, Venezuela, Iran, countries that have that are geostrategically important, that have play a part in the international economy, and that have not only developed sophisticated and nuanced ways of controlling their own societies, but which have expanded their influence beyond their own borders to have an influence over the state of democracy in their neighborhoods, and in the case of China, at least, throughout the world. But I would say the major message for the year is one of potential and opportunity, and this is because of what's happening in the Middle East. I've been at Freedom House for 19 years. For most of those years, when we would formulate the reports for Freedom in the World, we would always include a line that said, the Middle East is the only region that has not participated in the wave of democracies that's reached every other corner of the world. That's no longer true anymore, and that is, I think, the most important message that comes out of this year's report.
So, I guess we're going to start here. Arch, thank you very much. I mean, that was a great overview of, I think, a report that is extremely interesting on many levels. And I wanted to start, we already know, I think you have some biographies of the people who are sitting here. You now know Arch, but also Larry Diamond. We could call you Mr. Democracy, an expert, certainly, in democracy around the world. And then also Tamara Wittes, who was at the State Department, Near Eastern Affairs, and now is Senior Fellow Director of the Saban Center, very well-known center here in Washington on Middle East. And I wanted to start, actually, with the Middle East, because when I read this report, one of the main things that jumped out at me was Libya. I don't want to start too specifically on a country, but I think it's worthy of note. The last time we looked at Libya, in fact, next week, we'll be back at Benghazi hearings up on Capitol Hill. Libya looked like a place with a lot of problems. Certainly, the American ambassador and three other Americans were killed in that attack on the consulate. And now I read, Arch, in your report that there is some significant progress. So I wanted, just briefly, if you were both game, to jump into that, perhaps broaden it out a little bit to the Arab Spring countries. But could we start with Libya? Larry, let me start with you. Did that, when you read that, did that finding surprise you?
Well, you should start with Tamara, since she knows the region better than I do, but not really in the sense that, first of all, Libya started from as close to a totalitarian, although with a kind of very personalistic character to it, but extremely, extremely repressive. This was kind of, you know, a more quixotic version of Saddam Hussein, although because he had a populist and, you know, pseudo-democratic character and rhetoric to him, some people fell for his overtures and self-presentations of a misleading nature. But so Libya's come a remarkably long way. I'll just say this about Libya, and I think it's obvious, and then turn it over to Tamara. I think that it's premature to call Libya a democracy, because political order is still so fragile there, and the command of, by the state over the means of violence is still so inadequate that I think state building remains a major challenge. And until the militias can be reined in and the authority of this of the democratically elected state, now Freedom House judges, can really be firmly established, there's still a tremendous fragility and vulnerability in the unfolding story in Libya.
Mm-hmm. And Tamara, I see you shaking your head, so.
I think Larry is absolutely right. The dramatic gains that you see in Libya are, to a certain extent, an artifact of the fact that you're starting from the floor. There's almost nowhere to go but up. Mm-hmm. That is significant. It's tremendously significant and tremendously positive. But the sort of headline on this year's Freedom House report is breakthroughs in the balance, and I think Libya is a tremendously important breakthrough that is hanging in the balance. Two things I would note. The first, Larry's point about monopoly on the use of force and basic security being a condition for people to be able to exercise their freedoms. That link between security and democracy in Libya is still very much up in the air and something that we need to continue to care about and be engaged in trying to move in the right direction. I think you can carry that lesson about the relationship between stabilization, if we want to call it, or security, and politics across the region. That there are other places where we also care about stability, but the fundamental realization from the Arab awakening needs to be that stabilization will not occur without political stability that's rooted in consent. The second thing that I think is important and illustrative about Libya, without taking it too far, is that it was a case, there were elections in Egypt, Tunisia, and Libya over the last year, democratic elections. In Libya, the Islamists did not win. And we can't assume that because we've seen an Islamist resurgence in these societies in transition, that that is the wave, that that's the future. I think Libya is illustrative of the challenges Islamists face when they try to address real-world problems and when voters have real strong choices amongst parties. And so we need to keep our eye on political pluralism.
Mm. You know, as I look at this also, that practically the first line, Arch, that you have here, that it's an there's the ambiguous nature of these developments. Two competing trends, demands for change pushed forward by popular movements, democratic movements, and an authoritarian response that combines intransigence with strategic adaptability. So I'd like to get into that because it would appear, I mean, just going back 2 years ago with the Arab Spring, which is definitely one of the most, I think in my lifetime, one of the most important events. Spread out over quite a period. As we look at it, great hope. And yet, the adaptability of some repressive governments to be intransigent, but also strategic adaptability. Larry, what do you read into that? What would you say adaptability is?
A lot of different things in different countries. In Saudi Arabia, you know, you have a much more closed political system than in Morocco, even though both of them are monarchies. So in Saudi Arabia, strategic adaptability is just the emission of huge amounts of money and patronage to try and keep the population accepting and quiescent in the face of a regime that really isn't changing. In Morocco, you had a monarchy that was already utilizing more constitutional and competitive mechanisms, taking some initiative to get out in front in terms of constitutional change. But I think it's increasingly apparent in Morocco that this has been largely superficial, that not much has really changed, and that Morocco is still nearly as far from democracy, maybe not quite as much, but nearly as much as it was 2 years ago. It's certainly not even close to being a constitutional monarchy, which is what I think this society probably wants and needs. So, I mean, this will be revisited in a lot of these countries. And in Bahrain, what was strategic adaptability? It was Gulf Cooperation Council, maybe mainly Saudi troops, I'd say, with America quite obviously looking the other way, marching in while the movement for democracy was brutally crushed. Now, peaceful leaders of democratic sentiment, having had their life sentences confirmed after having been brutally tortured in detention, maybe not recently, but badly enough after they were arrested. Where's the United States been in this? Where has President Obama been? Where has his voice been while one of America's chief allies in the region and the home of the Fifth Fleet has been engaged in this kind of savage repression of its own society? I think these questions need to be raised by advocates of democracy and including friends of the Obama administration.
Hmm. Do you agree? Oh, I'm sorry.
Well, on the question of strategic adaptability, one thing I'd point to is the way that authoritarians have shifted their focus towards civil society. It used to be that authoritarians' first target would be the political parties. And in country after country, we've seen the traditional political parties either be co-opted or weakened or corrupted in some way, or just simply repressed by the leader. And replacing them as the focus of political opposition and advocacy for democracy has been NGOs, trade unions, and other forms of civil society. And these organizations have proliferated in societies that are, in many ways, quite authoritarian. And now you see, in country after country, Russia being the most obvious, but by no means the only country, new laws, new policies, new ways of operating aimed at circumscribing the abilities of civil society organizations to function as they should be functioning. These governments fear civil society activists because they are energetic, because they have initiative, because they understand how to use new technologies, and because they are not co-opted.
Well, just quickly on that, since, Arch, that really is one of the areas that you're specialized in Eurasia, Russia, do you feel that movement, let's call it, almost like a nascent, Arab Spring movement, but at least the people on the streets in Moscow, do you believe that movement is still alive and well? Because it seems to be pretty quiescent recently, and then you have this spate of new projected or proposed laws. Where are we with the opposition demonstration movement?
Well, I think right now the demonstration movement has been temporarily set back rather significantly. I mean, there's no question that if you prosecute people, if you threaten to put them in jail the way that Khodorkovsky was put in jail, you're going to probably get a response, and people are going to retreat. I don't think that this is something that can happen forever. Look, Russia has too many educated people. It has too many people involved in different causes and who care about different things. And you also have a government that, as surly and snarling as it is right now, does have a stake in improving the economy, improving the standard of living of people, and of opening Russia up to foreign investment, at least. So I do think that this hiccup that you're seeing right now will eventually have to subside, and then we'll see. The other thing I would say, though, is having spoken up about civil society, if you're going to have real political change, you have to have good political parties. In the end, you have to have elections, you have to have the reform forces powerful enough and organized in political parties so that they can succeed in that traditional way. And I would rather see in countries like Russia people mobilizing maybe in a little more quiet way than just simply street demonstrations. Street demonstrations have a way of alienating segments of the society that you want on your side.
Hmm. Tamara, you know, one thing that Larry was talking about is describing this Obama administration as being, you know, quiescent or accepting what some of its allies do, especially in the area of the Arab Spring. Is the United States doing enough in that area, or is it a difficult political calculus that they have to deal with?
It is inevitably a difficult calculus because the United States has a mix of interests, but the calculus is very different today than it was before 2011, and it should lead U.S. policy in very different directions. I think Larry actually put his finger on one of the biggest challenges facing the Obama administration as it opens this second term and deals with political change in the Middle East, which is that the drivers of change, the demographics, the concerns about inequality and corruption, the changes in technology and the media environment that have helped produce these demands for change, these drivers exist everywhere in the region, not only in the places where we've already seen political uprising. The demands for change exist everywhere in the region. What we've seen since the beginning of the Arab Awakening is some regimes trying to get ahead of the curve by undertaking reforms like Morocco, with more or less success, we'll see. Other regimes trying to get ahead of the demands in their own population using new repressive tools or accelerating the use of repressive tools. I believe that's destined to fail ultimately because these drivers are very deep-seated in society. They reflect real changes that have taken place in Arab societies over the last decade or more. The pressure's not going away. So the challenge for the United States is how to engage its Arab partners on the need for reform, continued reform across the region. Now, President Obama articulated this in his speech in May 2011. He said, it will be the policy of the United States to support democratic transitions and democratic reform across the region. But walking the walk on a day-to-day basis in the face of security and other interests, that is the challenge.
Mm-hmm. You know, another something that I had to clean my contact lenses when I read it was Burma. See if I can find that. I think it's the page before. Where, Arch, you were saying that it is it's in better shape than China. I can quickly find that.
It's got better freedom scores.
It's got better freedom scores than China.
Okay, again, it feels counterintuitive, but tell me, why? Why? Yes.
Well, to begin with, you've had the release of a high percentage of the political prisoners that had been in prison in some cases for quite a number of years. Second, you've had by-elections for parliament that were conducted in a relatively free and fair way, in which the opposition party did very well. Third, you've seen a resurgence of an independent media, and you've seen a proliferation of some civil society organizations and other indications that there are better civil liberties than in the past. But again, these changes are being stage managed by the same people who ran a dictatorship for decades, and you have these conflicts with ethnic minorities, at least three going on right now, and they are quite serious conflicts. So that's what prevents the gains in Burma from being more substantially recognized.
Tamara, did you have something?
Yeah, just to follow on Arch's point, because I think this gets at something very important. You can see improvements year on year in the Freedom House scores because of major political decisions that have been taken. But to truly see those trends remain over time and continued upward progress, you need to institutionalize those political decisions. And that's what we have to worry about in a place like Burma. Is this just will amongst leaders that's driven by interests and could change? Or is this going to turn into institutional reform? And I think this gets to the point Mark made in his introduction, the importance of giving grades. Because it does force you to look at whether things have stayed the same or continued to get better. Case in point in the Middle East is Yemen, where, you know, we've seen a negotiated transition of power, tremendously important, but the scores haven't changed. The Freedom House scores haven't changed. The democratic transition in Yemen is still just at the beginning. And so the Freedom House scores are a great tool to remind us of what's yet to be done.
Mm-hmm. Larry, what about, I wanted to get into China, especially, but did you have something on this particular part of it?
Well, on this point, let me generalize just slightly the points that have been made. I think that the changes in Burma are going to be institutionalized in the sense that Burma is going to be a different political system than it was before, say, 2010, and particularly before this year. It's going to be, it's not going to be a hard authoritarian regime any longer. The problem in Burma is the problem in Egypt, the problem you referred to in Yemen, and the problem in a lot of these countries in the world, that you can get stuck in a process of transition in what's been called a competitive authoritarian, or I would say another way of saying it that's more useful for my purpose at the moment, is a pseudo-democratic regime. There's a tremendous premium on democracy in the world. It's still the only form of government that's broadly legitimate in the world. And whether you're Hugo Chavez or the Burmese military and ruling party, you want to look democratic, but you don't want to risk losing power. And so the fear in Burma, and my fear, I might say, with the Muslim Brotherhood and President Morsi in Egypt, is that they'll keep the veneer, they'll have the competition, but in Egypt they will continue to so intimidate the press and civil society and opposition parties and insinuate themselves in the deep tissues of the state and perpetuate and deepen this cynical bargain they seem to have forged with the military. And in Burma, they'll contain the political opening so that you never get even to electoral democracy, not to mention liberal democracy.
Mm. And where would we put China?
China, unfortunately, you'd put China where we would have put it 10 or 15 years ago. Mm. It's no longer a totalitarian regime. In the classic language of political science now, we'd call it a post-totalitarian regime. There's certainly dramatically more personal freedom to move around and live your life and start a business than there used to be. There's some glimmers of more space for discussion and non-political organization and civil society, but there has just been no movement, zero, for I'd say 15 or 20 years on the big questions of political political structure. Are they going to move up elections from the fairly trivial level of villages to something more consequential? Is there going to be any independence of the judiciary and the legislature? Is there going to be any significant, genuine freedom of the press? Are they going to lift this incredibly ferocious control over the internet that they have? I think you have a deeply anxious leadership in China that knows its legitimacy is drifting away, that's sending its money and its children abroad in terms of their own personal money because they have no faith in the future of their own regime. And Xi Jinping is now facing an existential choice as to whether he's just going to hold the line for another 5 or 10 years on political reform because he's afraid of winding up like Gorbachev, or whether he's really going to become somewhat more creative and daring in this regard and try and rescue a process of incremental change and preserve the stability of the country, I'd say, in order to do that. Without that, I think the days of communist rule in China are now seriously numbered, and the transition, when it comes, could be really quite chaotic and jarring.
You know, there's an important country listed in here where, Arch, you've said that in Turkey, there's a full court press on the media and the opposition and an environment of fear. Tamara, would you agree with that?
I think that what we've seen in terms of prosecutions in Turkey is extremely troubling. And it has put a chill on debate in Turkey, on the press in Turkey. And, you know, this is after years where we've seen significant gains on the rights environment and legislation. It's dangerous, particularly at this moment when Turkey is beginning the process of constitutional revision, that you don't have a media sector that feels itself able to address these questions openly without fear of persecution. So this is another place where I think we've seen important progress, but to hold the line and to see continued forward progress, I think there needs to be continued pressure. And to be fair to the administration, I think this is an area, press freedom in Turkey, where you've seen some pretty explicit comments from Secretary Clinton and others.
Mm-hmm. You know, what we're going to do in terms just of timing is, in about maybe a couple of minutes, we can get into some questions, and we also have Twitter questions, et cetera. But I wanted to ask a question that I was talking with Arch a little bit before about, which is the countries, the kind of big influential countries like Brazil, China, Russia to a certain extent, that have a different take on calling on the carpet another country for its human rights or its freedom quotient. In other words, they say, we may not like it, we may not agree with what they're doing, but countries have the right to their own sovereignty. And why should we, who are we to have the right to tell them precisely what to do? I mean, you have different narratives on economic freedom, certainly development, China's narrative. And Russia on Syria is a perfect example of this drive to defend sovereignty. And I'd be interested in all of you just, you know, summing up kind of what your view on this is. Why do you, Arch, have the right to evaluate where they are? Countries seem to be, some other countries seem to say that you don't have the right to tell other countries what to do because they are sovereign. What do you say?
Well, the first thing I'd say is that many of the countries that are democracies, new democracies today, and which have decided that they will not be, that they will not interfere in their neighbors' affairs. They will not speak out. Brazil will not speak out about what's going on in Venezuela. South Africa will not speak out about what's going on in Zimbabwe. India will not speak out about what had been happening in Burma. That many of these countries are ignoring the tradition of outside moral intervention into their internal affairs that resulted in these countries gaining their freedom. South Africa is, I think, the most notable case here. South Africa, South African apartheid fell in large measure because of the intervention of Europe and, late in the game, the United States, all of the measures that were taken, the sanctions, the boycotts, all these measures had a huge impact on South Africa achieving majority rule. And in a country like Brazil, you had the, or let's say a country like Chile, you had the weight of moral opinion in Europe and in the United States that played important roles in their military dictatorships giving way, having elections, and then you in Brazil you had Lula elected, and then now you have Dilma Rousseff. To now say that because for sovereignty reasons, we don't have the right to speak out against a country like Zimbabwe, which is engaged in terrible kinds of persecutions, or in Venezuela, which has, to a certain extent, restored a kind of quasi-military government, which was always the curse of Latin America, I just think it's irresponsible.
Larry?
Well, first, I think we need to put it in perspective. If you look at American history, we, as rising democratic power, were not through much of our history much better, and at times not any better in terms of our own foreign policy. I mean, we were complicit in some military coups and displacements of democratically elected governments. We befriended and had strategic partnerships with people like Mobutu and Ferdinand Marcos, and I've already alluded to the fact that we still have a lot of these partnerships today with authoritarian regimes who are our strategic partners in various respects. At the same time, I think the world is in a very different place than it was then, and it's not just that there's a moral responsibility, is that these are really increasingly deeply codified in ways that are at the level of societal norms, universally recognized and deeply valued in documents as old as the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the International Covenant on Political Rights and Civil Liberties, or as recent as the Warsaw Declaration, which more than 100 countries signed, including democracies like South Africa and Brazil, in the year 2000, and we now have more or less 100 countries that are part of the community of democracies. And there is something that I think is now newer, but it's seeping into the international normative structure, called the responsibility to protect, which I think is now actively incumbent upon us in Mali and some other countries. So, on the one hand, you know, Brazil, India, South Africa, the rising powers, and they want to expand their regional economic and political influence, and they're responding to some of the traditional geopolitical concerns that I think might have shaped, to be frank and honest about it, U.S. policy in the Caribbean and Latin America through much of our history. But at the same time, I think Arch is absolutely right. We have to, we as an international democratic community and international civil society and their own civil societies have to call these governments to a higher common standard.
And yet tomorrow, at this point, there are efforts to weaken some of those international conventions on rights. Where do you stand on this?
Well, I think Larry's right that this that these norms and demands for human freedom are increasingly accepted as universal. And the fact that we have functioning democracies in every region of the world, representing every major cultural sphere, I think underscores that. But I guess, you know, what I would say is that for a country like Brazil or India, yes, the interests of a rising global power inevitably come into play. But these are also countries that are proud of their own democratic embrace and democratic transitions. And it's a question of how they engage states in transition or states that are struggling with these issues, not whether. I see multilateral organizations and institutions as a constructive way to go. I think if you look at the community of democracies, for example, Mongolia, you know, a relatively new democratic country, chairing the community of democracies, hosting very well-established democracies at an international meeting, or Brazil's leadership with the United States in the open government partnership, which is somewhat narrower, but it's dealing with government transparency, freedom of information, those sorts of norms that are crucial for democracies. So I think there are ways that these countries are willing to engage, but it might not necessarily be the name and shame variety of engagement.
I think it's time to open it up to questions. So I guess we've got quite a few. Let's see. At least I see a few hands out there. Is it gentleman in the back?
Yes, hello. Thank you. there are unrecognized territories also on the world map right now, and I noticed that Freedom House also graded these territories, like Abkhazia or like Nagorno-Karabakh in the Caucasus. And it was interesting to see that in some cases, these unrecognized territories were graded different from the metropolias, from the republics, from which these territories had seceded at some point. For example, Nagorno-Karabakh this time was graded as partly free formation versus Azerbaijan, which was actually graded as non-free country. And my question was whether you think that this situation, when these new formations, unrecognized formations, being more democratic, this factor should really become a factor for the peaceful, that should be considered within the peaceful negotiations, peaceful settlement of this conflict. Because if these new formations get back, hypothetically, to their former metropolias, then basically this would mean that the level of liberty and democracy will inevitably decrease in these territories. Now the people of those territories are enjoying more freedoms. So this is the question, whether this democratic incompatibility, if I can use this term, should be considered as a factor within peaceful negotiations of these conflicts.
Interesting.
You.
Arch?
I agree. I do. It's an interesting point. And of course, the first thing that came to mind was Hong Kong. Which we have for years given a separate score to before China took over when it was under British rule, and in that case, it may not be a solution that everybody is totally satisfied with, but Hong Kong has remained willy-nilly a quasi-democratic part of China, and it has a wide range of civil liberties, and it has a pretty good independent judiciary on most issues. So I think it would be very interesting if you had negotiations between Armenia and Azerbaijan for the control of Nagorno-Karabakh, if there were demands that if Azerbaijan was again going to gain control of that territory, it would have to make some serious political reforms, which I'm sure that President Aliyev has no intention of making. So I do agree with you. I think it's worthwhile. I think that any person, people in these territories should demand that democracy be on the agenda when the negotiations take place. But I think that when one of the partners in the talks is a confirmed authoritarian, carving out democratic space for the territory or for the entire country, it's going to be very hard.
Let's take another question. Yes, ma'am. That's fine.
I'm going to return to the topic of the Middle East and North Africa. I'm from the Project on Middle East Democracy, so it is of pertinent interest to us. I wanted to talk about the question of sort of a model for the region of effective democratization and political liberalization. For a while, before the Arab Spring, there was this sort of talk of the Turkish model as a potential example for other Arab countries to follow. With the rise of problems, the issues you mentioned in Turkey regarding press freedom, that seems to have more or less disappeared. After the Arab Spring began, there also emerged this discourse regarding the Moroccan model as an example of gradual transformation and democratization without insecurity and instability. It's been a year since the formation of the new Moroccan government. We haven't really seen dramatic changes despite the potential that existed with the new constitution. Is there a model that exists in the region, or does each country need to follow its own?
All right, Tamara.
I'm not sure I would necessarily hold up Morocco as a model. I'm not sure I'm as pessimistic as Larry, but I do think the question of whether the reforms that have been undertaken in the last year translate into anything meaningful is still very much an open question. I think the burden is on the Moroccan monarchy and the political parties and the institutions of parliament and the judiciary to seize the opportunities created by this reformed constitution and try and turn the aspiration into reality. And either the monarchy will enable that and facilitate that process, or it will stand as an obstacle, and then we'll have the answer. But I think for countries in the region that have already undergone radical change and where the societies have clearly put forward full electoral democracy as their goal, Morocco isn't going to be a model, and it shouldn't be a model. It might be a model for countries like Jordan or the monarchies of the Gulf that are struggling with how do you have change that's stabilizing rather than destabilizing. But for countries like Tunisia or Egypt or Libya, I think I'm not sure that there's an obvious model. I think that these societies and the civil societies and the political parties that I engage with are very interested in pulling from a lot of different models. They're interested in hearing from different countries, depending on the issue at stake. For example, Tunisia having a tremendous struggle right now over reform of the interior ministry and the police, which were at the heart of the Ben Ali regime. And this is crucial. It's also intensely politically sensitive. So, but they're not the first country to face this challenge. And so, you know, they can learn from the experiences of Germany at reunification and how the secret police files in East Germany were dealt with, for example. So I think they can take from a variety of models. The real challenge is, can they integrate those lessons through the lens of their own needs, their own political balance, their own political experience? And can a country like Tunisia say, yes, we have real polarization within our society between avowedly secular political movements and avowedly religious political movements, but we can find compromise, we can dialogue, and we can come up with a constitution that will work for us. These are the kinds of challenges that I think the transition states in North Africa are facing.
Let me just add, I think there is a model or something closer to a model than anything else, and it's Tunisia. It's the only democracy in the region, at least it's the only clear, firm state that's made the breakthrough to democracy. It's had the elements of compromise that Tamara has referred to that I think are quite significant, at least some degree of significant rethinking. And I think it's at least among many elements of Islamist political thought and political organization, I think it's sincere that I don't think the Muslim Brotherhood, as it now stands in Egypt, has even begun to really sincerely manifest. And there have been compromises, there have been tolerance, there is a serious search for the kind of institutionalization that Tamara mentioned earlier. And as a result, I just say, I think it is extremely important that the West support this experiment. With investment, with aid, with symbolic support, not just flows of democracy assistance, that's obvious. There are deep economic problems in Tunisia now. I mean, almost a crisis in terms of unemployment and so on. I mean, if Tunisia doesn't make it, with the fact that it's come the furthest now, and with the fact that if you look at, you know, the strength of secular and liberal norms previously, the advance of women's rights under Bourguiba and Ben Ali, even though we didn't like what they did in so many other respects, its level of economic development, its location on the Mediterranean. If Tunisia can't make it, what are the prospects for the rest of the Arab world?
Mm. You know, we have questions coming in by Twitter, or from people on Twitter. And there's one about a country that I actually have been paying a bit of attention to recently, Hungary. A very interesting case, and J_Ulfelder says, given developments in Hungary over the past year, why no downward trend? Why no change in score? Is that correct?
Hungary is one of those important countries that last year we had on our kind of watch list, along with Turkey, Ukraine, and South Africa. And last year, Hungary did get a downgrade, and even a bigger downgrade in our press freedom survey. There are clearly problems with the policies of the Orbán government. We did not downgrade Hungary this year because we saw that there was a pushback from the judiciary and from civil society on some of the questionable measures that had been proposed by the Orbán government. And, you know, the Orbán government is not to everyone's liking, but Hungary has not become an authoritarian society. And there are still all kinds of issues under contestation, even as the Fidesz party has a two-thirds majority in parliament, and there is pushback in the judiciary. There is a level of independence there as well. So I think there is a danger in exaggerating the anti-democratic instincts of the Orbán government. It is a problematic government, especially in that part of the world, which, since its neighbors by and large have become stable democracies, and Hungary itself is a kind of stable democracy, but I think it's a problem to exaggerate the decline there. There has been a decline. We've taken note of it, but we didn't pursue that this year because we just felt that the democratic institutions held firm against some questionable measures.
Okay. Do we have some more questions from our audience? Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Nadia Chow, Washington correspondent for Liberty Times. On China, first question, even though the category hasn't changed, you know, we also noticed that the civil society has been very active in the past few years. You know, some of the recent incidents, like Nanfang Zhoubao, the South Uyghur daily newspaper, the protest seems to have an impact on, you know, the government decision. I wonder, is there any, you know, a reason to be optimistic about the civil society's the influence or the force they can impose? And the second question for Taiwan, on a country has been put on the free category for many years. But recently, the opposition party, the biggest opposition party, filed a report complaining that they have been unfairly treated by the legal system. Because quite a few of the cases that a former or a current opposition leader were persecuted, but found innocent in the end. But they have suffered a lot for their reputation or, you know, the health condition. So I wonder, do you have any comments on Taiwan's judicial system and the party, the fairness of the party politics? Thanks.
Taiwan is one of the more impressive democracies of Asia, of East Asia. And it has a vigorous two-party system. And we have one party, the KMT, is now clearly in the ascendancy. But I mean, everything that I see about the functioning of Taiwanese democracy suggests to me that the freedoms in the country are not really in jeopardy right now. You just had over the weekend a massive demonstration led by the opposition party and by NGOs, in which the policies of the KMT government were severely criticized. You have a weakened president whose ratings are now down in the 16% level. It's true that there have been these prosecutions of leading DPP party members, but again, the judiciary did push back, and in most cases, those people have been exonerated and found not guilty. So even though I would say that there are clearly efforts by the KMT to take advantage of their majority and consolidate their power, the workings of Taiwanese democracy have basically prevented democratic institutions from being seriously eroded.
Let me make just a couple comments. First of all, I am very optimistic about the long-run prospects for democracy in China for the reasons you've articulated and that I have as well. Chinese society is just being dramatically and rapidly transformed. And there's rising evidence that the new generation not only lacks faith in communism anymore, they think it's a joke, and they're very cynical about their leadership, and they want democratic change, and they're increasingly developing tools and going ahead and exposing wrongdoing, protesting, organizing, achieving change. So change is going to happen in China. It's just a question of whether it's going to be sudden and potentially disruptive and potentially with some worrisome consequences for regional and international relations, or whether it's going to unfold in a more orderly and gradual and planned way that will lead to a softer and more peaceful landing to democracy like Taiwan negotiated. And I agree with what Arch said, and I just add one other point. I think he may not be very popular now, and maybe he's made a lot of mistakes, and you know, people can judge that in Taiwan. But actually, I lived in Taiwan for a year. I know President Ma. I think he is someone who is deeply, deeply committed to the rule of law and made and has honored a personal commitment to not interfere with the judiciary. If there are problems here, I think it's more a matter of prosecutorial zeal in Taiwan. And if you think prosecutorial zeal cannot happen in established and even liberal democracies, I suggest you Google the name Aaron Swartz.
Tamara, you had a
briefly, because it goes back to something Arch was saying earlier about strategic adaptability among autocrats, and I think it's absolutely right to point that out. But there has also been, and I think continues to be, a lot of adaptability within civil society, and learning across borders and across regions by civil society about how to resist, how to push back, and how to overcome the obstacles that autocratic leaders continue to throw up. Without taking away from the broader point that there is this intense campaign against freedom of association, and it's something that established democracies like the United States need to be concerned about, need to keep calling countries like Russia out on, I see civil society demonstrating a lot of resilience and creativity and flexibility in the face of that. And I think that gives us cause for optimism. Mm-hmm.
You know, I just wanted to raise one quick question about Mali, because it's in the news. It's quite striking how far it has fallen, how quickly the French are going in there. Should the U.S. be doing more, Larry?
Absolutely. I think we should be actively, I think it should be like Libya. We don't put boots on the ground, but otherwise we'll actively support both local African states in the region who want to roll back. It's both a security issue and a democracy issue at this point. And people are critical of the government of France now. They're getting into a quagmire. This should never have been allowed to get to this point. You had a liberal democracy in Mali, a president who was on his way out, an election that was about to happen, and a bunch of soldiers who were unhappy with the situation plunged the country into chaos and vulnerability. Well, you know, the world just stood by and kind of wrung their hands and responded, I'd say, regionally and internationally in quite an ineffectual way. And the problem worsened, and now you've got the whole country at risk. And Al-Qaeda of the Maghreb increasingly getting a foothold here. You know, many times we're forced to make painful choices between our security interests, for example, in rolling back or containing international terrorism and democracy. Here they're converging in an obvious and striking way. If we can't even respond forcefully in that kind of circumstance, then I think we are in a much more pitiful state than I had imagined only fairly recently.
Mm. And I'll add just one more note, which is, now that Mali has sadly arrived at the pass that it has, and now that there is international intervention, I think Syria should be a cautionary tale to the United States about not waiting too long. That, you know, what we've seen in Syria is a nonviolent popular uprising met with government brutality, morphing into an armed uprising, and then morphing into an increasingly communal conflict that creates more and more opportunity for violent extremists, including Al-Qaeda. What we see in Mali is Al-Qaeda of the Islamic Maghreb taking advantage of local grievances and local instability to advance its own agenda. And the longer this conflict goes on now, the more opportunity they will have. Already the jihadi forums are extolling Mali as the next great front. And so we have an interest not only in the outcome, but in seeing Mali return to a stable democratic path as quickly as possible.
Mm-hmm. Mark, I think you had a question.
Yeah.
Microphone.
Two quick questions, if not simple ones, for anybody who'd like to take it. Which is the most pernicious illiberal government in the world as an example for methods for quelling civil society, opposition, and voice? And then secondly, India, by all rights, is a tremendous success story as a market democracy. But there are those, for instance, of disadvantaged castes in the millions who have rights on paper but don't enjoy actual access to justice. What's the... When you look under the hood in India, what is the situation?
Mm. Who do you think should answer that, Mark?
Arch and Larry.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, I'll answer the first question. I would say at this moment, Russia is the country that is the most pernicious when it comes to suppressing civil society. I might not have said that a year ago, but in the wake of what's happened over the past 6 or 8 months, I would say that the ruthlessness with which Putin has moved to disrupt the funding of really important civil society groups, groups that did election monitoring, groups that monitor corruption, human rights groups, and the like, plus the, I think there's now a law on the books. I know it's been proposed and I think it's been passed, which forbids the propagation of gay rights ideas. Somebody could probably tell me that's on the, so you have a collection of laws and policies meant to suppress freedom of expression, civil society with any kind of a political undertone. You have Putin having steamrolled almost the entire Duma to support these things. So I would say that right now Putin is showing the most aggressiveness and the most cleverness, because he is also, of course, gone very aggressively towards cutting off relations between civil society organizations and civil society organizations and governments outside of Russia. And what's dangerous about that is it just stands there as a model for other countries to adopt.
Larry, I mean, the word pernicious, pretty strong.
I don't think it's strong enough.
I agree.
In the world, compared to any other country?
So let me come to India in just a second, but let me say I agree with everything Arch said. I think we now have, in, if you want to phrase it this way, Putin too, the second run of Putin as president, you know, a more overtly and unabashedly sinister figure. He's preserving the outward shell of a multi-party system, but this has gone from being, you know, very worrisome and, you know, obviously a descent from what arguably could have been considered during the Yeltsin era democracy to a non-democracy. Now it's going from a non-democracy with some elements of pluralism and so on to a really ugly authoritarian regime in which rights all over the place are at risk. And I just think we need to confront it more overtly. In the case of India, Mark, I'd say that, you know, it's such a big country. And both regionally, I mean, compare the more progressive, better governed states, you know, like Karnataka and so on, with Bihar, for example, you know, and you see just dramatic differences in the actual provision of rights and the quality of governance and the extent of democracy. Actually, you know, it might be an interesting exercise someday. I realize it would be just hugely difficult and expensive to try and do, apply the methodology of survey to at least the Freedom House survey to a number of the Indian states, because many of these states are a lot bigger than, you know, most of the states in the world, like the Chinese provinces. But in any case, I think there are multiple trends. So there's a right to information movement in India. The law has been passed. The civil society is mobilizing in a very creative and persistent way. The press is very vigorous. And yet you have a lot of this horrible stuff that continues to go on, not only these recent incidents of gang rape, but just the horrible suppression of the rights of women, minorities, lower caste groups, and so on. And I think the way to look at it is, you know, India is an electoral democracy with many elements that are liberal, and so it kind of barely rates as a free state and has for a long time, but with a lot of elements of corruption, bad governance, illiberalism, or so on. But, you know, with a lot of regional variation and with a quite historic and protracted ongoing struggle to deepen and improve democracy and the quality of governance. It's really one of the epic stories of our generation. And at least it's happening largely peacefully, constitutionally, or at least through the continuing kind of Gandhian style creative use of nonviolence. And I don't justify all of the wrongs and the shortcomings, but at least there is an ongoing peaceful legal effort that is having some effect in trying to improve the quality of democracy.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we have time for just one more question. Yes.
Tom Dine, I'm proud to say that I'm a member of the Freedom House board, and so one more time this report card has been issued, and hopefully we can all take advantage of it. In our discussion today, I've heard the United States or the Obama administration called quiescent. Others have used other words. But that doesn't explain the quiescence. That doesn't explain the passivity. That doesn't explain the non-intervention and the deep disappointment, at least to this person, who voted for Obama. Why are we sitting on our hands? Why aren't we doing something? It doesn't take a genius to figure out about Syria, starting in March of 2011. That everybody knew that where it was going to go. So I think in terms of the values of this country and the values of the civil societies that are represented in this room, we need a better explanation of why we're not getting the foreign policy that we deserve.
Okay, Tamara, perfect question for you. How do you defend? Where I want to see how you answer this.
Okay, well, let me start by being very clear. I don't work for the Obama administration anymore, and I'm not here representing them. Let me tell you, Tom, a little bit about what I feel we confronted as we sought to advance this agenda. We confronted an American public that, for understandable reasons, is exhausted with foreign entanglements and wary of new ones. We confronted the worst economy in nearly a century that demanded focused attention and investment of political capital. We confronted a Congress that, first of all, for the most part, doesn't care about foreign policy. And doesn't value working on foreign policy. And secondly, given the economy and given the budget environment, is interested in cutting all kinds of money spent on engagement abroad. And so, you know, when we were developing an effort at a robust response to the Arab awakening, to support the transition in Tunisia, to support positive change across the Middle East. We were essentially doing it with no appropriations bill having passed that year. And you might remember the government almost shut down in April of 2011. We were doing it essentially with the change we found in the couch cushions. Now, money isn't everything, and I don't want to say that it is. Public statements are also not everything. But I think for the United States, given that the US is a global power and it does have a global mix of interests, to be credible in advancing this agenda, it has to do more than say nice words. It has to have a package that is compelling, a package of pressure and incentives, and most of all, a warm welcome for societies that are moving in the right direction. Now, when the Berlin Wall fell, there was a bipartisan consensus on the need to invest in creating such a structure. But there were also existing institutions, the European Union and NATO, that provided an architecture for countries that needed to know what's the road look like and what are the milestones and what do I get if I go down that road. We don't have any of that for the Middle East even now. It needs to be built. But I don't think it can be built without bipartisan consensus and without the support of the American people.
I think we're going to have to leave it there, as they say, in television. But
save me from getting into trouble.
Well, we can have the fisticuffs later, but I just wanted to thank you very much, Arch, Larry, and Tamara. It was a very interesting discussion. Thank you.
I also, again, want to thank Mark and CFR for partnering with us and hosting us here today. A perfect venue for this. We greatly appreciate it. If I can use the phrase, it takes a team to produce an event. A lot of people from Freedom House, and I know CFR, too, put today's event together. There are five people in particular who have been working on this for a long time in putting today's event together. I want to thank Mary and Nina and Liz and Erica and Karen and also Daniel for all the work that went into producing today's event, putting the panel together. Terrific panel discussion. I really appreciate it. I want to end with one final point, and it picks up on something Larry was saying about Russia and the need for pushback on what's been happening. It certainly is not a perfect solution. It's not a whole solution, but thanks to overwhelming bipartisan support in the U.S. Congress late last year, the Congress passed legislation called the Sergei Magnitsky Act that seeks to target Russian officials involved in gross human rights abuses. My hope is that we will see other democracies, in particular in Europe, pass similar legislation, and then we'll also see efforts to make this kind of bill global in nature again, it's not the only answer to the problems we face, but Freedom House was part of the push for this legislation. I'm proud that we were associated with it, and at least is some part of the way to try to push back on these authoritarian trends that we see, not just in Russia, but in other parts of the world. Thank you all for coming. Thank you to the panel again, and we'll see you next year.